Johnny Cash, I Still Miss Someone, here at the home of Americana Music 92.1 FM Radio New Braunfels. I am very, very honored and excited sitting here with me, William Beckmann.
How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm excited. Thank you for having me.
I'm so excited. My gosh, I have 100 questions to ask you.
Okay.
What'd you have for lunch?
You know what? I had some mahi. I was with Randy at McAdoo's, and that's one of our favorite restaurants.
The mahi Boudreaux?
That is exactly what I had.
That's my favorite
really good.
Thing there, yeah. Mm. Should have brought Randy. Next time we'll drag him up here.
He didn't. He didn't know he was invited, but you know.
Oh, he's always invited.
Awesome.
He knows that. So, well, the reason we're here talking today is because you're going to be playing, well, kind of a home away from home for you, too, next weekend.
Yes, Green Hall. We're excited about it.
Two nights in a row, Friday and Saturday night.
Can you believe it?
I can, and I think the last time I saw you was, oh, and I have to say this. Dude, you saved the day on the Americana Jam when Jack couldn't make it, and you just showed up and played for us. That was amazing.
Well, I appreciate everything y'all do for me, and y'all play my music a lot, so anything I could do to pay it forward. Thank y'all for doing that. And yeah, it worked out. I love doing that. Anytime I get a chance to do it, please y'all let me know.
Don't tell me that because
I mean it.
Yeah, when Jack did has anyone been able to give Jack a hard time other than Mattson about not showing up? And then, I mean, you really did just step in and save the day.
I love Jack. Yeah. I did it for him one other time at Steamboat. He couldn't make it. I think it was, yeah, he got sick. And so I stepped in for him.
What's the common denominator here, Jack?
He's my boy, though.
Yeah, he's wonderful.
If Ingram's listening, I love him.
We love Jack. William stepped in and played Randy on the stage. And then you didn't forget to play Volver. I was almost didn't play it, and then right at the end, it was amazing. I had some friends in town from high school, like some friends of mine from high school, and I mean, we're very old. And then some friends of mine were in, and one of my friend's mothers was with us, and she texted me the next day, and she was like, "Who was that kid that came in? He was so good, the one with the deep, deep voice. He was so, so good." So,
sang in Spanish and the whole thing.
Yeah, it was really, really incredible.
At this point, if I don't sing at least one song in Spanish, I get in trouble.
I get that.
People get mad.
I get that.
So it's like, at this point, I just got to keep doing it.
I lived in a border town for many, many years, and you got to speak a little bit of Spanish at least.
You do.
You know?
Otherwise, people start picking on you. You don't know what they're saying, so you got to learn how to speak Spanish early on in life.
That's the best.
So you can defend yourself.
When they're picking on you and you're like, "I know what you just said." You think I don't, but I do. All right. So I was going to ask you this. At what moment in your career did you say, "You know what? I think this is going to work." Was it sold out Corona Club? Was it the Grand Ole Opry? It was probably playing Roots and Branches for us here, right?
Honestly, I don't know if I've ever had that thought that this is going to work. I mean, look, I'm kidding. I mean, I've been very blessed and very grateful to have some amazing opportunities in the last couple years. But you know, it is at the end of the day, it's a job, and I'm just trying to work. I think looking at the whole thing, the fact that I've got so many good friends and so many great mentors, I think that's probably the thing that makes me feel the safest, you know. But as far as like knowing if it's going to work or not, I mean, I like playing music, and I just do what I do. And
I think we can safely say it's going to work.
Well, I appreciate that. Yeah, I appreciate that. But yeah, I mean, the Grand Ole Opry was a really, really big milestone for me. We just did... it was my first time at Red Rocks. We did it with Parker McCollum and the Randy Rogers Band. And I'd never been there before. I'd never even seen a show there. So to be there for the first time and to be on stage was really surreal. There's several pinch me moments that I find myself in. And, you know, it's just part of the journey. It's the coolest part of what I do.
Yeah, and realizing that it is a job and having to treat it that way when so many don't, that makes a big difference.
Right, absolutely. But yeah, I'm very grateful for all the support in New Braunfels and the support that y'all give me and all the, you know, the great community here.
Oh man, we love you. Thank you. So speaking of influences, and we're all well aware what a big influence Radney Foster was for you.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, Robin gave me just a little bit of information on you, and she said, ask him about his grandfather.
Yeah, wow. I'm glad Robin brought that up. Yeah, my grandfather's a you know, he's still around, my dad's dad, and he's like been my biggest fan since I was first starting to get into music. And I'm 28 now, and when I was first getting into it, I was doing piano lessons and learning how to sing a little bit, and that morphed into me playing guitar. But he's always, he never did music, but he could like carry a tune. Like he could sing, and he'd love singing mariachi songs, and we'd get together and sing some songs. And every once in a blue moon, I'll bring him out. If he's at a show, I'll bring him out on stage, and we'll do El Rey or something together, and it's cool. Like it chokes him up. But yeah, like, he's the earliest one that I could remember that was really encouraging me to do it. You know, my parents thought it was cool that I was doing piano lessons and playing guitar, but he was the one that was like, hey man, if you really love this, you should do it, kind of thing.
Did your parents or your grandfather encourage you to take those piano lessons, or is that something you wanted to do?
I think I was the one that started the conversation, and they were very supportive of it. And but yeah, music's always been something that I've loved, and I just remember watching, you know, CMT music videos and stuff when I was a kid, and just being really fascinated with anybody on stage or country singers. I loved George Strait, and I was infatuated with music and being an entertainer. And so I tried to fit, you know. And also growing up in Del Rio, there's not a whole lot to do. I mean, my brother played sports and stuff, and I did too, but music was the one thing that I like really looked forward to at the end of the day. And so I did piano lessons, and that was fun for a little while, but I picked up guitar after that. And then kind of, it's easier to take a guitar around than it is a piano, so
a little
I
bit.
You know.
A little bit. But I mean, if I could go back, I mean, I can play guitar a little bit, but if I could go back, it would be piano. You'd learn so much more, you know, music theory and all that.
Yeah, and it, like my memory of taking piano lessons was you know, learning whatever it was. I mean, just like I was learning how to read music, which was fun, but that's not really what I wanted to do, especially the songs that we were learning that my piano teacher was making me play.
I can imagine.
It wasn't what I wanted to be doing. Like, I wanted to go, and I was like, I want you to teach me how to play Let It Be by the Beatles, you know? Like, I want you to teach me how to play something, you know, an Elvis song or something. Like, I was learning, like, I remember from my piano recital, this is crazy, I must have been in the third grade or the fourth grade, and I played the theme song to The Godfather, because that's like my dad's favorite movie. And so I played that song for my dad, and I had to read all the, yeah, I actually did pretty good. I don't think I messed up once, but
that's a heavy song.
Well, I practiced for like 3 months straight, so I would have been very upset had I messed something up. But anyway, it started off piano, then guitar, then singing, and then I got into high school, and that turned into Radney Foster taking me under his wing and teaching me how to write songs. And then I got into college, and then I started trying to actually apply myself into the...
Yeah, did you go straight to Belmont?
No, I was in Austin for a couple of years, and then I went to Belmont. I went to school at St. Edward's University, and then I went to Belmont for 2 years. But Radney was a big part of my life the whole time.
Yeah.
He was teaching, you know, he'd let me send him songs, and he'd critique me, give me constructive criticism, and say, hey, this song's great, you know, this first verse is a little weak, you might want to go back and revisit that. And I'm like, okay. And he'd give me pointers and stuff. So my experience writing songs was always like, what would Radney do? And if I really needed an answer, I would send it to him and say, hey, you know, I feel like this is pretty strong, but I don't know. And you know, he'd always come back with something. And it wasn't until like a few years later, I'd send him something. He's like, man, I think this is great. I don't have anything to say. And that's when I was like, oh man, okay, now we're getting somewhere. Because
that's high praise.
Right, yeah. So, but yeah, Radney is my boy. I love him.
I love him
to death.
We all love Radney. So I see you brought your guitar.
I do have my guitar.
Would you mind playing a song for us?
Absolutely. I can I'll play this song. I just put this I put a record out. It's called Here's to You, Here's to Me. And I laugh with my band because when we're on the road too much and everybody starts complaining, I said, man, the only people that are on the road longer than us are truck drivers. And so I wrote this truck driver song, and I put it on this record. It's called Bad Dreams and Amphetamines. Two. Well, the road is getting lonely, just like they said it always would. God knows I'm getting weary, I'd quit tomorrow if I could. But you're the reason that I'm out here, 1,000 miles away, with nothing but 18 wheels and another week of pay. And I pull over when I'm supposed to, crawl in the back and go to bed. But sleep out here so hard to find, when I can't get you out of my head. I've got a pill for every problem, but I've got too many problems, so it seems. I'm either flying down the highway, or I'm stuck in between bad dreams and amphetamines. The morning brings another nightmare in another foreign place. Sometimes I sit and wonder if you'd recognize my face. I picked up in San Francisco and hauled a heavy load to Maine. Every mile that I'm driving drives me a little more insane. And I pull over when I'm supposed to, crawl in the back and go to bed. But sleep out here so hard to find, when I can't get you out of my head. And there's a pill for every problem, but I've got too many problems, so it seems. I'm either flying down the highway, or I'm stuck in between bad dreams and amphetamines. Bad dreams and amphetamines. It's the memories we ain't making, it's the words I forget to say, that make my mind and body question the time that I spend away. And there's a pill for every problem, but I've got too many problems, so it seems. I'm either flying down the highway, or I'm stuck in between bad dreams and amphetamines. Bad dreams and amphetamines.
Beautiful, beautiful. Let's take a quick break, and we come back. We'll talk a little bit more, maybe play another one for us.
I'd love that.
All right, let's do it. FM Radio New Braunfels. We're doing this online, Facebook Live, and on the air. Rachel Swann in studio with William Beckmann. Super duper excited to have him here. Thank you for stopping by and hanging out.
Thank
with
you
us.
For having me.
What was it? We got a comment. Is there anything he can't do?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I heard you can do impressions too.
Oh my God! Who did Robin tell you that?
I don't know. Maybe I don't know. Are you?
I can do a couple impressions. I don't know. I mean, I used
you
to
turn
some...
every shade of red just now.
I did, because I'm thinking about what I did for her and whether or not I can do it on air or not.
I mean, you know.
I'll have to wait till I have a couple beers.
Okay.
Yeah.
Go, Paige, go grab him some bourbon whiskey. I think we got some bourbon whiskey in the back. So she gave me some really good information that maybe not everybody knows. I mean, we all know about, you know, Rodney Foster. We know. Oh, I was going to ask you about this, too. You were so nice. You went to Belmont, you said, for a couple of years, and then you were so nice. Americana Jam, I don't think it was this past year. I think it was year before. My daughter is thinking about going up there and going to school, and she came up and asked you about, you know, going to school there, mm-hmm. and if you thought it was worth it. And I mean, you really took the time to just answer and talk to her and tell her a little bit. Do you remember any of that?
I vaguely remember that. Yeah, I get a couple people to ask me about my experience there, and I tell them all the same thing. I had a great time there. Granted, I was only there for 2 years. Like I didn't spend my whole 4 years of my college education there. Because, you know, the first 2 years of college, everybody kind of dreads, you know, it's all the basic courses and stuff. So when I transferred in, I got to jump right into the cool stuff, and I think that kind of made it a better experience for me. But you meet so many incredibly talented people out there at Belmont in Nashville, and I had a great time. So I always encourage anybody that's trying to get into music or wants to learn more about their craft, whether it's songwriting or singing or just the business side of things, I always encourage it because of my experience. Did your daughter ever end up?
She's here playing.
Okay,
like,
cool.
She's gigging pretty regular around here, but she's, you know, toying with the idea of going up to Nashville.
Yeah,
and doing that. So she's thinking about it. She was just, it's expensive, and mm-hmm. is it worth, you know, going to school to learn the business side of it, or even the networking aspect of it?
The networking thing's a big thing too. But honestly, I mean, if I'm being completely, honest, I went to Nashville and I moved there when I was 19 and, you know, I was there for 2 or 3 years and it wasn't till I graduated and I told my folks that I wanted to pursue a career in music, that I moved back to Texas and I got connected. You know, Radney helped me a bunch and up in Nashville. We wrote a bunch of songs and stuff, but it wasn't really till I started immersing myself back in Texas and touring and doing stuff that things really started to kind of
happen.
Right. You gotta, the easiest way to learn something is to go out and do it. And of course, Wade Bowen and Randy Rogers and Parker McCollum and all those guys were always so sweet to me and let me open up shows for them. So I went from playing little honky tonks and little coffee shops in Texas and even little places doing writers rounds in Nashville to opening up these really big shows and getting the exposure that I needed back then. And so you know, it's just one of those things. I guess what I'm trying to say is, do you learn a lot by going to Nashville and meeting people up there? Yes. Do you learn just as much touring and being a road dog here in Texas? Probably. You know, it's just however you want to skin it.
And then when you came to Texas, you moved to Austin?
Right. I came back to Texas, and I still have a place in Nashville. I still have a publishing deal up there that requires me to go up there every couple of weeks and write and stuff. But no, I split my time between San Antonio and Nashville.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So maybe I'm making this up. Did you live kind of behind the Continental Club?
I did.
Okay.
That was before I'd moved to Nashville.
Oh.
That was I'd lived in Austin first, and then I lived in Nashville. Then
that's why you had to sneak in because you
I got yes. Did Robin tell you that story?
I don't know.
Yeah, no, I can tell that story now. I was 19 years old, and I was living at these apartments that are kind of behind the Continental Club, and I would every Monday. Dale Watson, he had this residency there, and he'd play every Monday, and I loved Dale Watson, so I had this fake ID that I would sneak in there with, and I'd go see Dale Watson every Monday night. And my next door neighbor, who was like my biggest fan, and she was older than I was. She was in her 30s. I was 19, and she was my biggest fan and was there. And was like, "Oh my God, you got to get up on stage and sing." I was like, no, I'm not gonna do that." And long story short, she was drunk and kind of spilled the beans that I was 19. You know, she like went to the manager or somebody behind the bar, says, "You got to get this kid up here. You know, he's 19 and whatever." And Dale had already kind of somehow agreed to let me get up on stage. So basically what happened, it was like this perfect storm of Dale Watson's now inviting me up on stage to sing. She's over behind the bar telling the manager that I'm 19, not knowing that I'm already getting up on stage. So now I'm on stage. The manager of the place knows that I'm not even supposed to be in there. I sing two songs with Dale Watson. The crowd went wild, and they hurled me out the back door. Like these two bouncers took me off stage and kicked me out the back door and told me never to come back. And anyway, Celeste is a friend of mine, and she runs the Continental Club. And she, I tell her that story. I was like, you know, you told me never to come. Just, you know, somebody here told me never to come back. And she's like, you're welcome here anytime. So I think they took it back.
Now that you're legal.
Right.
Now that you're legal. Just in case anyone's listening.
I know.
They only said that now that you're legal. So your friend had the best of intentions, but actually.
Absolutely. She kind of ruined it, but it's okay.
Yeah. I mean, that's happened to all of us, the best of intentions. And then, you know, we open our mouth after a couple drinks. I mean, not me. I don't do that. But some people do. All right. Well, I think I'm going to ask you to play another one if you don't mind.
Oh, I'd love to.
All right.
You want to? You mentioned In the Dark. That's off my old record.
I love that song.
I can definitely play that one for you.
I love it.
Okay. Let me. I also have to. Give my drummer Jeremy a shout out. He said he was tuning in, so he was going to get upset if I didn't mention his name. Hi, Jeremy. Where'd you go, baby? How'd you disappear? Did you go looking for freedom in some town far away from here? 'Cause I can see you in the distance of a faded memory. I should have known you had your fingers crossed every time you said that you loved me. Now I can't find a single answer, 'cause you left me in the dark. How am I supposed to carry onward? What am I supposed to tell my heart? Well, there's whiskey in the bottle, but it won't be there for long. If I keep asking all these questions, wondering if I did something wrong. Now I'm locked up in our bedroom, like a prisoner in a cell. Spend too much time thinking about you, and too many nights going through hell. Now I can't find a single answer, 'cause you left me in the dark. How am I supposed to carry onward? What am I supposed to tell my heart? 'Cause I still love you. Oh, what a foolish thing to say. 'Cause I'm sure I have not crossed your mind in at least 100 days. Oh, but I just want you to light my world up once again. I can't accept the fact that you and I have reached the end. I wish I would have known you were gonna leave me feeling blue. Makes me wonder why I ever wasted all my time loving you. Now I can't find a single answer, 'cause you left me in the dark. How am I supposed to carry onward? What am I supposed to tell my heart now? Where'd you go, baby? How'd you disappear? Did you go looking for freedom in some town far away from here?
Beautiful. Love that so much. Thank you for playing that. I went somewhere else. I forgot what I was going to ask. I'm in the dark somewhere.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's all I got. All right. And I was going to ask you about coming back to do Roots and Branches. It was that's probably the first time Paige you ever saw him live was Roots and Branches, right? Or no, the Americana Jam. The jam last year, yeah. You get up on stage, you're so humble, and then you open your mouth and this like audible honey comes out of your mouth. Wow. This beautiful
thank you.
Beautiful sound. Love it, love it. Have you always had that voice?
No. It kinda came I learned how to sing just by listening to the people that I liked, but I used to sing a lot of. In the first band that I was in, we did like a lot of Eagles and really like difficult songs, and I always had the highest voice in the band.
The harmonies,
right? Yeah. So they would make me sing all the big high ones, and then I got older, and then I sort of discovered that I can sing the low ones a little bit better, and so I got real into Johnny Cash and those guys. But I was like, not too many people are surprised by this, but like I love old school, like what I call traditional pop, like. Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin, like all the pop music of like the 50s and 60s. And I just think it's like the most suave kind of what style of singing. I just think it's really cool and sexy. And I just, so I was always attracted to that style of music. And I'd watch all these Frank Sinatra videos and listen to all those albums. And he's got a big round voice and big vibrato. And so I liked that. And when I was still learning how to sing, I think that I kind of incorporated that into my singing, and it just kind of stuck there.
It's beautiful.
But yeah, it's I've always just listened to things that I like, and I'm like, ooh, I like the way that person does this, and I think it'd be cool. And then I kind of just tried to find my own voice from all of that. But yeah, I did not. It took me a while to figure out how to sing, because I didn't come from a musical family, so it was more of like me just listening to what I liked and trying to learn myself.
But your grandfather obviously knew.
Yeah, my grandfather, again, like my grandfather doesn't play any music or anything, but he could carry a tune. Like he could, if you put on a song that he knew, he could probably hold his own in karaoke or something, you know. But I took basically that and tried to, you know, make a career out of it.
Well, I could sit here and talk with you all day. At some point, we're going to have to talk about the show. The show is actually... Two back-to-back at Green Hall. Is that the last time you played here? Was Americana Jam in May in the area?
I believe so. Yeah. I believe that is.
So Green Hall.
I was with Randy on that on stage with that one.
That was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have another song in you? If I asked you,
sure. Play? Yeah. What do you? Let me tune this back up. So give me 2 seconds.
But, can I ask you to play Volver?
Yeah, of course.
Really? We're gonna have to turn the mics way down, guys.
Yeah, it's going to give me 2 seconds to tune this up. I can do something.
I mean, that's what you got to do. You got to tune. You get tune it or die, you know. William Beckmann, while he's tuning up, just a reminder, go to greenhall.com to get those tickets. These shows are both going to sell out. If they're not as of about an hour ago, I checked. But greenhall.com, they will sell out. You want to make sure you get your tickets sooner rather than later. And, I mean, every chance William gets to do this one... rocked it on the Grand Ole Opry stage, rocked it at Americana Jam in May, and thankfully he's going to play this one for us. It's probably the most requested mariachi tune, I would say.
I would agree with that, yeah. And it's funny because a lot of people at my shows are now requesting it.
Don't know what they're singing, but they...
You're right. All right, here we go. Este amor apasionado anda todo alborotado por volver. Voy camino a la locura y aunque todo me tortura, sé querer. No Nos dejamos hace tiempo, pero me llegó el momento de perder. Tú tenías mucha razón y le hago caso al corazón. Y me muero por volver. Y volver, volver, volver a tus brazos otra vez. Llegaría hasta donde estés. Yo sé perder, quiero volver, volver, volver. Nos dejamos hace tiempo, pero me llegó el momento de perder. Tú tenías mucha razón y le hago caso al corazón. Y me muero por volver. Y volver, volver, tus brazos otra vez. Llegaría hasta donde estés. Yo sé perder, quiero volver, volver, Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. So, again, make sure you go get your tickets, greenhall.com. Anything else you got going on?
Just a new record out. Go stream it. Go support it. It means a lot to me. And these two Green Hall shows, we're looking forward to it.
Looking forward to having you back in town.
Thank y'all so much for everything.
Oh, man. Amazing. How about we do, let's listen to one more William Beckmann tune. Happen to love this one, This Heart of Mine on
awesome.
KNBT.
Awesome. Thank you.